When I was 12, a new mask shop opened in our town just before Halloween. The store was small, tucked away between two boarded-up buildings on a forgotten stretch of road, and it didn't even have a sign. But the window display was enough to catch my attention. Dozens of masks, each one unique, each one more lifelike and unsettling than the last. Some were grotesque, with twisted features and hollow eyes. Others were so detailed that I almost expected them to blink. My friends and I were instantly drawn to it. Halloween was just around the corner, and this new shop felt like it had appeared just for us. We pushed open the door and stepped inside. The air thick with a strange, sweet smell, like old candy and wood polish. Behind the counter stood an elderly man, tall and thin, with eyes that seemed too sharp and intense for someone his age. He smiled at us, a slow, crooked grin, and beckoned us inside. "Welcome, welcome," he said in a voice that sounded like creaking floorboards. "Each mask is one of a kind. They don't just transform your face, but your spirit." We laughed nervously, thinking he was just trying to make a sale. But as we looked around the shop, examining each mask, we couldn't shake the feeling that there was something alive about them. The eyes seemed to follow us, the expressions shifting ever so slightly when we weren't looking directly at them. "Go ahead, try one on," the man encouraged, his smile widening. "Choose wisely, though. The mask chooses you as much as you choose it." My friends and I split up, each of us wandering through the aisles. I found a mask that looked like a wolf's face, its teeth sharp and its eyes gleaming. There was a strange allure to it, and when I held it up to my face, it felt cool, almost cold, against my skin. Just then, I heard my friend Danny call out from the other aisle. "Check this one out, it's creepy," she said, holding up a mask of a smiling clown, its face frozen in a disturbing, exaggerated grin. She slipped it on and giggled, making goofy faces at us. But the moment she put it on, her expression changed. She stopped laughing, her movements stiffening. She looked at us through the mask, her eyes wide, almost frantic. "Danny?" I said, feeling uneasy. She didn't respond. Instead, she began moving in jerky, unnatural motions, as though her body wasn't entirely her own. She looked into the mirror, tilting her head back and forth, her hand slowly reaching up to touch the mask. "Danny, are you okay?" Max asked, laughing nervously. He reached out to pull the mask off her face, but she slapped his hand away, hard, her eyes still wide and unblinking. "Leave it on," she whispered, her voice soft, but different. It didn't sound like Danny at all. It was higher, childlike, with a twisted edge to it. We all stared at her, confused and a little freaked out. She wouldn't let any of us near her, standing there, staring at herself in the mirror with that same frozen expression. Then, just as suddenly as she'd put it on, she pulled the mask off, her eyes wide and her face pale. I don't know what just happened," she whispered, clutching the mask in her hands like it was something she couldn't bear to let go of. The old man watched us, his eyes gleaming with a strange satisfaction. "Sometimes the mask reveals a part of you you didn't know was there," he said softly, as if explaining some grand, unsettling truth. We exchanged uneasy glances, each of us a little shaken. But there was something almost magnetic about the masks. Despite what had happened to Danny, none of us wanted to leave without one. One by one, we each found a mask that called to us. Max picked a sinister-looking jester with a twisted smile and eyes that glinted with a mischievous sparkle. Lily chose a fox mask, sly and elegant, its features sharp and cunning. I couldn't resist the wolf mask, even after what had happened to Danny. Something about it felt right. The man handed us each a brown paper bag to put our masks in, and as we paid, he gave us a final warning. "Remember," he said, his voice low, "once you wear the mask on Halloween night, it's yours, forever." We laughed it off, thinking it was just his way of adding a bit of Halloween mystery. But that night, as I lay in bed, I couldn't shake the feeling that his words were meant as more than just a scare. Halloween arrived, and we were all excited to wear our masks. As we gathered in the street, each of us slipped on our chosen mask. The transformation was instant. I felt a surge of energy, wild and exhilarating, as if the mask had unlocked something hidden within me. My senses felt sharper, my movements more agile, like I could leap and bound through the night with the instincts of a predator. But as the night went on, something changed. I began to feel trapped, like the mask was tightening around my face, refusing to let go. My friends were acting strange too. Max's laughter grew louder, more manic, echoing down the streets as he performed wild, exaggerated movements. Lily moved with a quiet grace, almost too graceful, her eyes darting around as if she was looking for prey. Danny, with her clown mask, simply stood still, her head tilted, her eyes staring at something none of us could see. When I reached out to pull my mask off, I found that it wouldn't budge. The edges felt like they had melted into my skin, becoming a part of me. "Guys," I said, panic creeping into my voice, I can't take mine off." Max laughed, but there was no warmth in it. His eyes gleamed through the jester mask, his mouth twisted in a grin that looked too wide, too forced. "Isn't it fun, though?" he whispered, his voice a distorted echo of his own. One by one, we all realized the same thing. The masks were no longer just costumes. They were us. I could feel the wolf within me, growling and clawing, urging me to run, to hunt. I looked at my friends, each of them lost in their own mask, their own twisted identity. We tried everything to remove them, clawing at the edges, pulling until our skin burned, but the masks wouldn't come off. They had become our faces, our identities, binding us to the roles we'd chosen. In the distance, I thought I saw the old man standing at the edge of the street, watching us, his crooked smile visible even from afar. I tried to scream, to call out to him, but only a low, feral growl escaped my throat. As the clock struck midnight, we were still wandering the streets, our faces twisted into the masks that we could never remove. And as Halloween faded into the night, I understood the old man's final words. The mask wasn't just a costume, it was who we had become, and it was forever.